Welcome back to Chapters Network Live. And again, we're at the NSTV studios, and it's such a great place to film, to broadcast, to learn, to teach, and just to bring people together. So we want to thank everybody behind the scenes and on the set and administration-wise as well. They're doing a great job. We can't wait to do more and more shows. And speaking of shows, a lot of our shows now will be on their platform, NSTV, so you want to check your local listings for dates and times for that. But as far as Chapters Network, we're broken up into four components. We have Chapters Community Support Services, which is a clinical and case management piece that we work with individuals and families that are going through transition or dealing with any kind of adversities. We have our Chapters Network, which is, this is a big part of. We have about 15 TV podcast shows that are broadcasted on local cable outlets and some cable outlets around the country. So we do radio shows as well. So we're currently on WGBB on Long Island and also TAN Talk in Florida. It's simulcasted every Wednesday night. In Florida, it goes to Tampa Bay, Clearwater, and St. Petersburg. And in Long Island, also parts of Queens and Connecticut and Brooklyn. So we're excited about what we do every Wednesday night. The third component to what we do is called Next Chapter, which was established in December. What we have is a rotating distribution center where our program offers free food, clothing, and toys to communities in need. So we've been doing that once or twice a month since December of 2023. So we've been able to, that kind of started after the pandemic, what we all went through, the challenges that we all faced. So we saw the need, that ongoing food insecurities with families and people in need. And the final piece, which is also established in December of 2023, is our Chapters Network All-Star Band, which I'm very proud. We have a bunch of professional musicians. We have also young people that have overcome challenges and adversities themselves, which are talented musicians in their own right. So we had our first show on April 21st at the Warehouse in Amityville, and we have two upcoming shows. We're going to be headlining at the Spina Bifida Walk at Eisenhower Park on Saturday, September 18th, and on June 30th, we're going to be at Morgan Park in Glen Cove, honoring Dwight Gooden and a couple of amazing people that will receive Lifetime Achievement Awards and Youth Hero Awards as well. So we have so much to offer, and we're so excited because we're putting it all together. But really, the platform is to bring people on that are doing the same thing in a big, big way. And today, we have Jake Rinaldo from EAD, who is doing amazing things for so many years. Jake, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. Thank you to have me.
Yeah, thank you for coming. So talk about EAD.
Well, yeah, sure. You know, it was during the pandemic, you know, which seems to trigger all these little entrepreneur ideas. As you know from our discussions, you know, I've been in the music industry, recording, producing, editing, just helping people build careers. So during the pandemic, all of that stuff kind of came to a screeching halt, and I was sitting in the studio and I was listening, because we have a little separate area where we do rehearsals for bands.
Right.
And that was my whole thing coming up in the 80s and the 90s. We had rehearsal rooms, we had recording rooms, we were doing rental live shows. I don't know, but if you're familiar with Levittown, they had the nightclub, Spit.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, so we were doing a lot of productions out of Spit.
Wow.
We worked with Steve I.
Okay.
We did some big productions with him. We did fundraisers for cancer.
Wow.
With him and his mother. See, we got his mother involved.
Wow.
And, you know, as far as all of that experience and knowledge and bringing professional musicians and people of in the industry that I've been working with, I always had entities dealing with people with disabilities, being
right.
that I'm disabled.
Right.
I'm surrounded by, I guess, associates that do have different forms of disabilities.
Mm.
And, you know, working with different communities and with autism and cerebral palsy and there's so many of them, deaf, blind. We worked with a lot of different blind artists, rap artists.
Wow.
And the one guy I was working with that really struck a nerve was this artist called Blind Fury. And he also won the 106 in Park on the beat, the BET. And, you know, he that was run by Puff Daddy and all of that. And they did that whole demo in my studio. I produced it with them. So I thought to myself, you know what? I could do this for other people. Of course, I was getting paid for that stuff.
Right, right.
But, you know, these other people, they can't afford it.
Right.
So I was thinking to myself, wow, maybe I'll create a nonprofit organization and have people help raise money so we could produce other artists that are just as good as him, if right. not better.
Wow. Let me stop for a second, because you mentioned the pandemic, and we're going to go back into the foundation and the passion behind it. Giving all everything you've done up until the pandemic and when everything shut down, was that hard for you? Was it a period of transition? Because some people remained stagnant, and some people pivoted to do what they're doing now since March of 2020.
That pandemic was the greatest thing that could ever happen for us. Not for the country.
Right.
But it really helped us pivot into this direction, big time. And the purpose of, when I say pivot into this direction, was to open up my mind to help people that really can't afford the services.
Right.
And a lot of these individuals that any form of a disability or learning problem, you know, or just any sort of, you know, lack of ability to manage themselves, whether it be because of their disability or, you know, just not having the access to funds and all of that stuff. So it really triggered, because that, like I said, that rap group was done right before the pandemic.
Right.
Then it kind of blew up. And then I started to realize that other people are deserving of this too, if we could just, you know, get the funding, which, you know, was me then.
Right.
I started backing them.
Right.
And then they would come into the studio and we would start to get ideas of their music and their songs, because all the artists that I work with, they're basically, you know, they write their own material.
Right.
And then if they need help, we'll come up with ideas for music and, you know, and that's where production comes in.
Right.
So a lot of the musicians that are disabled, they don't have the ability to really arrange their music.
Right.
So they have a bunch of ideas and they'll come in and, you know, sometimes the song is 6 minutes long.
Right.
It's like, you know, how many times are you gonna repeat?
Right.
You know, so it's that type of education that we're, you know, we're teaching them arrangements and how to make the song just flow, you know, and
right.
keep everybody interested, not to lose them in the first
right.
15 seconds. You
and
know?
That's so very important. I love that aspect, because lyrically and music-wise, it sounds like you have that ear and that experience
correct.
To set limits, to cut here, to add here, to make it where people want to hear and see what's occurring. But let's backtrack so our new viewers out there, because it's a new platform that we're here today. Talk about your journey medically and how it all started for you, and why it started, and the passion behind of really wanting to help others.
Well, I mean, as you see, you know, I'm disabled. I have a muscular dystrophy. I was born with it. At an early age, there wasn't really anything noticeable about, you know, my situation. It seemed like a pretty normal. I had the ability to, you know, run, jump at an early age. It started affecting me when I hit my 13, 14 years of age, in my teens. Up until that point, you know, I was doing the music, I was learning, studying, you know, I was, you know, music theory. I was really heavily into you know, writing and transposing and just the basic theory behind music. But I learned on the guitar, the clarinet, and doing drums. Drums was like my first experimenting with, you know, production, so to speak. And then I started writing. And then from there, I got a little four track, and then, you know, so, but as I developed into that recording, writing, and producing, you know, the disability was brought upon me, and it kind of was like, wow, so this is gonna kind of crush some of my abilities.
So you're a young boy, you're a teenager when this is all unfolding. So how did that hit you? Were you sad? Were you angry? Were you like confused? I mean, what was your emotions behind it when it was first unfolding for you?
I was confused, you know, to be honest with you. Of course I was saddened and disappointed. But most of all, I was confused because, you know, I guess I was fortunate enough in life that you get these things thrown at you and you either wilter to it or you stand up to it. And for whatever reason, I didn't let it inhibit my goal to get involved with the music production. Mm-hmm. It did kind of inhibit my goal to be a performer, though, because I always loved to play. We had we were writing all original music, and we were doing it right in my garage, and we were young. I started around 10, 11 years old, you know, with the drums, and then I moved to guitar, and then I had the local guys, and my brother Rich, who's a big part of EAD, and a big part of why I wanted to start this program, because he's really talented musician too, and he has, you know, and we all have our idiosyncrasies, so to speak, you know, and the whole purpose of really getting involved with, you know, the music production was, I just like to write music and I like to perform, and you know, it just fell into place. Well, another thing too, we, because all our friends were into music, so one of our friends, his father was working for Atlantic Records, and he was a studio engineer, maintenance engineer, and they have the luxury of taking over all that, all the equipment, the stuff that Atlantic Records is gonna, you know, throw away,
right?
You know, because back in those days, especially, you know, tape machines, and before you know it, ADAT machines and DAT machines, and you know, it just turned into a whole digital world. So all of those pieces of equipment were left for whoever.
And Atlantic Records is no joke. They're the real deal.
But here's the thing. It doesn't matter the record company. It matters the engineer behind the machinery.
Okay.
So we went in there and we paid for our studio time.
Right.
And it came out like a three-track recording, not even four-track. It was like, but I make my four-track sound better than this.
Really?
So that's when it really kicked in. I was like, I can't allow people to disrupt the integrity of how we're trying to, you know, especially sound-wise, you know, because, you know, especially being a guitar player and a drummer, you know, there's a very specific sound that a musician or a songwriter will look for. And it's even more important in rap music, you know.
So despite that confusion when you were younger, you had this internal drive to do what you wanted to do, what you felt that you were working towards, even at a young age, you mentioned 10. How'd you get that drive? Where'd that come from? Where do you think that came from?
Well, like I said, you know, I was kind of lucky because even today, when there's a block, so you're heading down a channel, and then, and this was just inherited to me. When somebody blocks that channel, whether it be your disability or, you know, any disappointing thing that could probably, you know, inhibit your moving ahead, what my natural ability was is to move to the right. So what kept me going was the ability to not see the blockage, is to just go into a direction that we could find a happy medium, mm-hmm. you know. So my goal, my talents are management. I have pretty good management skills. And as I was growing up, I didn't mention, but we had a music store. My grandfather started Corette Music Center East Meadow.
Okay.
Right across from the medical center. Mm-hmm. So as a child, 7, 8, 9 years old, wow. growing up in a music store, working on trumpets, violins, and everything, you tend to develop those skills right. of, well, the trumpet is stuck and I can't get the valve out. So we could do this, we could do that, we could try this. So you have options of getting your goal.
So through your grandfather's story, you were like troubleshooting these little situations.
It kind of gave me the tools, right?
Oh, wow, okay.
Yeah, it kind of gave me the tools to think that way.
Right.
You know, it's all the way a person is going to think. And I was fortunate to have that type of thinking where I was, all right, you know, this is getting blocked from us, so let's move in a different direction.
Right.
You know, sidestep this blockage, and where could we take this to if we go in this direction?
Right.
And I started to learn, too, at an early age, because I was working with my cousin, mm-hmm. and he was producing Public Enemy, that rap group. And I was like, that's where all the money is. Mm. You know, he's sitting back there pushing buttons and collecting checks. Nobody knows who he is.
Right.
You know, so I'm like, wow.
So you learn then that you don't have to be in front,
right.
you have to be behind the scenes and be more entrepreneur, business savvy.
Right. The management skills.
The management skills.
Because he was like, I mean, this is a guy that right out of high school, he became a millionaire.
Wow.
So I was just like, wow. That's like amazing, you know.
Right.
I mean, because I was starting, you know, don't forget, he's my little cousin.
Right.
You know, he's probably about more than, I guess he's about 10 years younger than me.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I was always, he's always little G, you know, and then all of a sudden, little G turned into this, like, you know, business tycoon.
Wow.
And I was like, wow. So, you know, how that happened, it's just, I guess it's just born in you, you know?
Right.
The family has that certain knack, like my grandfather had that certain knack where wow. he was a monster. There was no way he couldn't mm-hmm. succeed. You know, he was just so hard and so bullheaded and, you know, there was nothing gonna stop him. So, you know, it's probably inherited in that fashion.
So that knack, that inheritance came from your grandfather, it seems like, and that kind of the thread that got you to what you're doing today.
Right, exactly.
Well, interesting.
Right, exactly.
So as things, you grew through your teenage years into your early 20s and late 20s, how did that affect you physically, but also professionally? Where did you take us through that time?
Well, definitely there was a bit of an insecureness, you know? I guess it's just being in those adolescent stages where, right. you know, now I don't really worry about what people think, but mm-hmm. back then it seems like you're always, well, what is this person gonna think? What is that person gonna think? And it wasn't something that was good for me, you know, because you're worrying about something you have no control over, you know,
right.
and I learned all of these things as I was going along. But as far as like, you know, I mean, it's hard to explain, really. The actual effectiveness that it had on me growing up was basically worrying of my ability to get around because, you know, I was very unstable, you know, and I fall a lot or I can't climb upstairs or, you know, traveling was hard, but I managed to do it. I don't know.
Just did you ever have a moment where I can't do this anymore? I can't because of the physical challenges. Or did you kind of have those brief moments and overcome them?
Yeah, I never let it hold me back. I never said I can't do it. It was always a concern of how I'm going to do it and not look like a embarrass myself.
Right. So that's the message that you do today.
Right.
How do people overcome those challenges, whatever they are? How do they get to the point where they want to get to? Correct.
Right. And not feel embarrassed.
Right.
You know, have the respect. Because if you talk to the musicians in EAD, they all say the same thing. They want to have the respect from their peers.
Right.
They don't want people to look at them for their disability.
Right.
You know, we got this guy, his name is Rick Pally.
Mm-hmm.
He's an amazing bassist. He played with Chuck Berry, a bunch of jazz guys. I don't know, but he's been around. And in his 60s or 50s, he got hit with Parkinson's. So I have an interview on my website, which is EAWD.org.
There you go, just do the plug.
EAWD.org will show you everything. So if you guys want to see interviews of people that are up and coming, writing books, and just living out their careers through EAD, it's on EAWD.org, and you go to the artist section or the blog section, and it will give you a whole rundown of all the artists that we're dealing with and their dreams and their goals.
Right.
But yeah, it's taught to them that, you know, you cannot feel insecure or, I'm not really using the right word.
Mm-hmm.
But usually when you have a disability, you get defensive.
Oh, okay.
You know, so you're on the
alert.
Yeah, it's like, you know, what is this person? You know,
so
it's
you
like,
guard it. You kind of guard it.
Yes.
Oh,
yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And how does that guard stay up, or has it come down in your estimation?
Well, I'm not a counselor, but through my counseling, I explained to them through my situation and how I handle it, because the one thing whoever I deal with, no matter what level of musicianship, there's a found respect that they get that these artists want to get.
Right.
Why they give it to me, I think it's because of my attitude.
Right.
And I try to explain that to them, you know. Rick Pally, I don't have a problem with, because he's been there, done that, you know.
Right.
I mean, he's just been around the world. He's done TV shows. He's in his late 60s now, or early 70s, something like that. But as far as people like him, but guys like Mike Mignone, he is a cerebral palsy drummer, and he has a book coming out. It's called Look Ma, No Feet. And he gets these complexities sometimes where he's, you know, trying to, I guess, focus on a path for himself and a direction. And, you know, there are certain things that are possible and certain things that are not possible. So using myself as an example, you know, it helps them see a direction that is doable for them and not, you know, like, for example, you know, if I wanted to go jump on a plane right now, there's no way I'm going to do it, you know, not with the chair and trying to transfer and everything. But in certain people's mind, they think they could do it.
Right.
So it's that type of training and teaching that we have limits.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so we're gonna expose our limits, and then we're gonna figure out ways to overcome those limits.
Right.
But you gotta first embrace your limits, and then through the, you know, through my own showing of how I do it, you know, my own experience and knowledge and success in what I'm doing, this is what you get for following these specific paths that we need to take, you know. And with Mike, you know, he's definitely, he wants to do drum clinics, you know, because, you know, we're, well, rest his soul, Dom Famularo was a big part of Mike's trainings.
Right.
You know, and he helped him develop a lot of techniques. And this other gentleman, Bobby Rondinelli, he's also a union drummer who toured around the world with, you know, Sabbath, Ozzy, and, you know, all the metal.
Well, we're gonna take a little commercial break, but before we go to that commercial break, a little word from the Ruth Eckhart Hall, which is located in Florida, because we have a lot of friends in Florida. It's a great venue. But there's a song out there. You talked about music. Sexy Handyman. Is that the name of the song?
Yes.
So talk about that song.
Well, during the pandemic, I was sitting in the studio and, you know, so my brother, he is doesn't have the ability to sit still.
Right.
So that pandemic, if I didn't come up with a, that's why I'm saying EAD spurred it from this, because it was that problem I was seeing, that he was going into, like, you know, cabin fever attacks, you know, and, you know, he has to go out. He goes out, and, you know, he's a true hardcore musician. So as far as his ideas of where the songs come from, and it's the name of his album, it's called Songs from the Universe.
Okay.
And he says that there is just this messaging that comes to him, and then through his experiences, which had a lot to do with his ex-girlfriends and just his quest to try to find a companion, you know, he came up with this song called Sexy Handyman, which in his mind, I guess that's what he was for this girl that he was seeing, because every time she needed something, she would call him, and then
we'll take a commercial break, and we'll come back with Jake Rinaldo. Stay with us. Well, welcome back to Chapters Network. We're sitting here with Jake Rinaldo. And Jake, we're talking about your brother. You mentioned your grandfather. Talk about family. I know you're married for 19 years, right?
That's correct.
To your lovely wife, Lee. Talk about family and what Lee means to you.
Wow, she's everything to me. I mean, and I never really understood it, 'cause I sort of got married, I was in my 40s. So when you're single for that long, you don't really understand a companion and their support, and what they, you know, how they give you that ability to really push ahead. Being a single, you always make different decisions really on your own basis of what you're doing.
Right.
As we became a team, it taught me that I could be more of who I want to be and have the physical support, not just the love, but the, you know, the that whole confidence in what I'm doing. Because when you're single, you don't really, you know, it's just you and yourself, and you're making decisions based off of your own confidence. But it's a little different when you have somebody that is backing you up and supporting you and giving you that extra comfort and confidence and support that you don't get when you are single.
Right.
And I realized that in my later years when I hit my 40s. I was like, wow, this is like, and not only that, I became less, I had less ability to do things on my own too. So it was almost like a God's gift. Mm. You know, I was like, wow, there's really a God up there, you know, because in my mind, I knew it was gonna, you know, go down to having, you know, a health aide to help me, you know, just with my everyday thing. Mm-hmm. But I never really thought I was going to find a loving wife.
Wow.
To, you know, to really be that support, you know, be that health care. You know, yeah, I mean, that was one of the things when you're growing up, you see all these people with muscular dystrophy and
right.
all this other stuff. You know, they had an aide with them 24/7.
Right.
I was fortunate enough not to need that until I hit my 40s.
Oh, I see.
So, but I didn't even have that. I started having it a little bit because when I met my wife, I met her dabbling on the internet, you know?
Okay.
So I didn't realize, but I'm talking to my wife, and she's in the Philippines.
Okay.
Because my wife is a Filipina. And, you know, we're just chatting, joking, everything. Mm-hmm. And I was like, well, why don't you try to give me a call, you know? And she says, well, I can't call you. It's going to be too much expensive. I says, why? Where are you? She says, oh, I'm in the Philippines. So that's one thing weird about the internet, you know?
Well, I mean,
you think you're talking to somebody maybe over in New York or Jersey. And
a little far away from Levittown.
So, I mean, at that point, you know, I was like, well, it'll be cool to, because I was planning to take a trip anyway. I was
going to,
I had some people that, business people that I work with in California. And I figured, let me go out there and, you know, handle some business and try to, you know, build on what I've been doing, you know.
Right.
And then it was kind of falling because during the process of building the studio and the recording and everything, I was doing world music.
Okay.
And the world music literally takes you to places that
internationally. Sure.
Yeah. And so when I was doing the world music and traveling to mainly South America, because it was something called Punta Rock. It's mm-hmm. like a Honduran, African, Spanish, Caribbean flavored style music. They mix it all together and they call it, well, it's Punta. The original acoustic version is mm-hmm. Punta. And then the people that I produced the new record, they were called the Garifuna Kids. So it's a culture. It's a Garifuna culture, which is African, Spanish. It's
oh, wow.
And it comes up through Africa, and it comes up through, like, Central America and all of that blend. So as far as, like, producing them, and I, you know, Punta Rock, you know, because they were using keyboards and mm-hmm. electronic drums and, you know, with the Punta, it's all acoustic African drum and acoustic
right.
guitar. It's all acoustic. Punta Rock, we brought all the digital stuff in.
There we go.
So doing the Punta Rock was so cool, man, because it was just so out of what I've been doing, you know.
Right.
And I mean, you could talk to any musician, even Eric Clapton, and, you know, he'll say, listen, you get tired of the,
right.
you know, the same old thing, you know. It's not that he wasn't appreciating that he wrote beautiful songs, but when you start playing the same songs every
right.
week.
And that's what people want to hear, too.
Yeah. It's like, all right. So it was really great for me to start in this Punta Rock thing.
Right.
And it took me traveling, and I was, like, famous in areas where you'd never be expecting
wow.
people would know you. And so once we got into that for, I would say, 10 years. It was a stretch of 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
Started to die down. Because now they're not Garifuna kids. They're
right.
not 17,
right.
18 anymore. Now they're 30s.
Their parents married and all that kind
right.
of stuff.
So, they, you know, they're trying to create a legacy from that,
mm-hmm.
which the managers and the promoters, they were robbing them kids,
right.
you know, so.
You bring up a point, I want to address this point, because the platform that we provide is an empowering one, to be proactive, to inspire others. And you bring up a point, because you were traveling all around the world, it seems like. With a disability, Can you talk to those people that may have some form of disability that are a little anxious about traveling, how that affected you, how you overcame that? Was it challenging for you at all times? Can you share a little bit of your feelings so maybe you can inspire others in that way?
Well, sure. The main important thing, you gotta have support. You know, and you gotta have courage, you know, because the one of my endeavors took me down to El Salvador. Mm-hmm. Now, El Salvador, that's a rough, rough place, you know. Right. Nobody in a wheelchair could really, because the roads, and it's like a mess. So at that time, I wasn't in a wheelchair, but I was dragging a cane around.
Right.
And I was struggling getting on and off buses. So one of the groups that I produced, because not only did I do the Punta Rock ethnic music, I did Spanish rap, which was based out of El Salvador. And then I also did like a Christian rock band that was funded by the church.
Right.
So the priest wanted to bring me down there to do shows and do radio and stuff like that. So when I went down there, I mean, you gotta be brave, you know, and you gotta hope that you got the support, because I was literally jumping off the, you know, in El Salvador, they don't stop the bus.
Mm-hmm.
So they slow down and you gotta jump off.
Right.
So I was like, there's no way. So I'm like, bro, you get off and you just be right there and I'm gonna jump on your back. Takes guts.
So you have that drive within you.
Gotta have the guts.
You have to have the guts, the courage, the drive, the passion, and the end game. You have to go into what seems like what you've been doing your whole life is to have these blinders on, not understand the negativity that's around you, but don't get caught up in it.
Correct.
Right?
Correct. And have courage.
Right.
You know, be surrounded by people that you can trust, that has your back. You know, if they have your back, like my wife has my back, that support is so big, you know? And if you get a good friend that's gonna be like, don't worry, I got you, you know? If you need help getting on and off the plane, I got you. If you're gonna need help in and out of the bus, I got you.
Right.
You know, so you gotta just find that companion, whether it be a strong woman or, you know, a couple of guys that have a passion to what your passion is.
Right.
Because that was the thing, I found the right people that had the same passion as me.
Right.
So now, you know, we did the record, stuff sounds great. We pressed them. We did the artwork. We had a bunch of CDs. So where do we go from here?
Right.
We got to go to the radio, you know.
Right.
We got to
start
promoting it. And that sucker went number one, the rap group.
Wow.
The first week we were down there, we went all to the radio stations. It's not like over here in New York, you know.
Right.
Over there, you could walk in, oh, in New York, oh, rap, boom, they put you right in.
Right.
Right away, you're getting interviews and... Then on the bus on the way back, all of a sudden I hear the song being played on the radio. That quick.
So that's rewarding right there. I mean, that's a sense of accomplishment, a sense of achievement.
I built their careers.
Yeah.
If it wasn't for me, they would have had no career.
Wow.
It was me taking them under the wing. I had found a financial... The guy that was doing the Punta Rock, he was the investor in all of that. So I told him this would be good to do, you know, Spanish hip hop. And you know, he's from California and South Central, all that, and you know, they had all the Spanish, you know, stuff coming out of Mexico there. So he invested and you know, he did well with it.
Right.
And the band had a career.
Right.
So the same thing we could do with guys like Mike or guys like Tom Ryan, mm-hmm. who has autism. He's also a singer-songwriter.
Okay.
But he doesn't have the direction or the management to get him in the studio, arrange and produce his stuff. We're doing that now for him. you know, and that's being funded by the Huntington Arts Council.
Okay. Now, when you look back on it, and before we talk about that, there's another song I want to get out there. What song do you want everybody to see on this show today? I know on the radio we put out a couple of songs recently, but what song should we highlight right now?
There is a song that we're working on that Rich wrote that is just amazing. It's called Nothing Without Love.
This meditation all seems worthwhile. Real love and hope and a little smile. We can make it better if we work real hard. Like a trip to China, we gotta dig real far. You can do what you wanna do. You can do what you wanna. You can do what you wanna do. But you can't do nothing, no, nothing.
Do nothing without love. And it's on EAWD.org under the artists tab, under the artist section, and you could see the video. We did a pre-production video of the song, and you can get an idea of it. But that would be everybody that hears that song, they just, wow, yeah, they love it.
Well, so we get a little personal here. So talk about one memory of your wedding day, and also Rich, what he means to you and your relationship with your brother.
Well, the one thing that touched my soul was when my wife sang to me. She got up there and it was a song about how, you know, I came into her life, and I can't remember the title of it. But it was so touching. What I did was, because my wife was from the Philippines, it was mostly Maya family, you know, Italian family. Mm. We had about, I can't even believe I had 200 people. This is my family, yeah.
Wow, a lot of pasta that day, huh?
So what we ended up doing was, because again, Rich is playing, he had the band, he was working with this other drummer who sang, he had a horn section.
Wow.
So I said, you know what, learn some standards, whatever, and play at the wedding.
Oh.
That was amazing. And just to see how the family reacted towards that, that was amazing. And then when my wife got up there and sang, you know, it was just...
Did you know she was going to do that?
No.
Wow.
No, I didn't
wow.
know that. Wow. She had that all planned out.
Okay.
You know, being from the Philippines, I never did karaoke before.
Okay.
So when I went to the Philippines, I was like, oh, man.
You're Elvis Presley down there.
We had such a blast with it, you know. And I had an aide come with me, too.
Okay.
And again, most of these aides, they're foreign, you know. So this guy, Henry, he was from Ghana, Africa. What a trip.
Wow.
So, you know, going there and learning about their, you know, their world, so to speak, and how they operate, and bringing all this karaoke. And when she came here, she brought karaoke with her.
Mm.
And, you know, it was as simple as just having her on the mic,
mm-hmm.
plugging this karaoke mic, it's called the magic mic, right into the PA, and she just sang. Boom.
Wow.
It was just all set for her. And that was really great. The way my brother put the band together, the way she did her little presentation, the way the whole family reacted to it, you know.
Wow.
So it was...
Cherished moment.
Yeah, it was a unique wedding, you know. Mm-hmm. It's not like your standard wedding where, you know, they just go in there and people dance all day. You know?
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, there was kind of a theme to it.
Good. Talk about your brother Rich real quick, because he's been your a big support and vice versa.
Rich is great. And that was one of the reasons why I wanted to do it, because he's got a heart as big as the universe, you know. And so when he says things and he talks to people, and it's just all about love and respect and really doing the best he could possibly do to make people happy, you know. And he does it in his work. We have a repair shop. EAD not only does music, but we also teach musical instrument repair.
Right.
And Rich is an expert on guitars, anything, saxophones, trombone, you know, brass, woodwind, strings.
Wow.
Top at what he does, because he cares, and he's really servicing the public with his heart and his love and caring to make that person happy.
Right.
So he's that kind of guy, you know. And with EAD, you know, he'll bring Rick Pally to gigs, because Rick has Parkinson's, so he really can't get around.
Right.
He has an aide too, 24/7, but he can't really walk. So my brother is concerned, you know, because he doesn't want the guy to be stuck in the house.
Right.
So he goes there, he picks him up, he brings him, makes sure he doesn't fall over, you know, because there's never really a stable chair for him, and he stands right there, and he makes sure his bass is good, and it's like he literally worries. He gets worried for the guy.
Right.
So
that thread of compassion.
Big time.
Big time. But that's run through your family, which inspires you for EAD, Empowering Artists with Disabilities. What's the word empowering mean for you?
Well, it's exactly it. That's why we chose the word empowering, because this is what we're doing. We're giving the artist, and it's just not with music either. We're empowering the artist to pursue their artistic dream. And by empowering them, it means teaching them, guiding them, making suggestions, creating a program, you know, directing them. And that's the empowering part, you know, because once you set a platform for them, that's the empowerment.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
We're working with a girl upstate because we have a big support of the Huntington Arts Council, and they allowed me to sponsor an artist from up in Lake George.
Okay.
And she's a multimedia film photographer and graphic design artist.
Wow.
And developing her own magazine, and she struggles with autism.
Wow.
She's at a high level functioning, but there's still struggles with, you know, putting together the programs,
wow,
you know, creating that platform.
Wow.
It's not, everybody thinks, oh, I'm just gonna put out 52 videos on Facebook.
Doesn't work that way.
Nah, it doesn't work.
Now we're running out of time, but I want you to look into the camera. I want you to think about all the people that, and give a shout out to those people that made what you do possible. I know you might miss a couple, because I would miss a couple, but if you look into the camera, just heartfelt, what they mean to you and who those people might be.
Oh, wow. Well, I want to definitely thank Maggie Ryan, which is Tom Ryan's mother. She's been a big, big support and a big advocate to what I'm doing and helping me make the proper decisions. Glenn Matheson, amazing keyboard player. I want to thank him so much for working with me and developing the video courses that will be online on the EAWD.org website. I want to thank Brian Okren. He's been a big support for EAD, and his wife, Laura Okren. She's a big help with helping organize and creating plans for the, you know, for the programs that are in place for the year. And I want to also thank my friend Chris Loggia. He is a very close friend of mine, and he's the drummer. He's a standby drummer that always backs us up, because a lot of the guys Well, he has a disability too, because he got into a bad car accident. But a lot of the drummers, like there's another guy, Mike Zielinski, and his brother, and his father, he's like his brother, Tom Zielinski. Those guys are great. Mike Zielinski also has cerebral palsy, and they've been a big help with the support of EAD. And then there's so many other guys like Ed Silk, Tom Owen, Kyla Silk, all of these people that help put these events together that we do, fundraiser events. There's one gentleman, he's a drummer, his name is Kevin. He was a big help. His wife, too. They were big supporters of what we do. My wife, Lee, big supporter. My dad, Vinny, he's a big help. You know, they support and they get behind us with everything we do. There's so many people that really, really, my brother Rich brought into that really support all the professional musicians from all the open mic nights. EAD is being supported by all the open mic nights, but from the Loft to the Knights of Columbus to even the tavern right down where we live on Newbridge.
Now we do, we're gonna end it, we do a little segment called New York Minute. So I'm gonna ask you two questions, you tell me what first comes to mind. How's that, all right?
Sure.
Favorite Italian dish?
Favorite Italian dish?
Yeah.
That's hard. You know what, I'm gonna go with the penne alla vodka.
Okay, why that?
It's probably the worst thing I could eat, but it's so delicious.
And last one, favorite concert you ever been to?
Wow, Genesis,
Phil Collins.
Yeah, Genesis. That's when they first started laser lights too.
Right.
And then everybody started doing it. But yeah, I'll never forget that concert. Genesis blew me away. I saw right there where the concert scene was gonna, you know, Pink Floyd started doing it.
Yeah.
And
then
they had that laser light show in the city. So, but Phil and all of those guys, they did, it was amazing. And we had like looking straight at the stage.
Oh, wow.
So the laser light show was like, wow.
Wow.
And besides, Genesis was such
iconic bands.
You know, I'm a musician of that era, you know, Emerson, Lake and Palmer.
Okay.
You know, Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of our arrangements were not as complicated, but when you're a musician and you study music, you really learn a lot of stuff from their classical backgrounds. And that's kind of, you know, and Genesis did it really good because they were able to bring it into a real commercial field.
Now, we got one more thing, and we're really out of time. It seems to me, and thank you, this has been a wonderful hour. You're an amazing man with an amazing journey and experience, and you have a lot more to offer. Do you feel like you have unfinished business?
Absolutely. It kind of frustrated me a little over the years because I've helped so many people, you know, with their careers. I've turned them into very successful careers. And it seems like they could care less about who got them there. It's just the fact of the matter is they're there. And it kind of hurts in a way that they don't give you any credit for helping them, you know? And so, I started realizing I gotta stop doing that, you know? You know, because the pay is not that great, you know? And then they get paid, and now all of a sudden, where's mine?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, I mean, but with EAD, it's not about the money. It's more about the ability to create something that is gonna go worldwide.
Right.
And EAD could go worldwide, you know. I know for a fact it could go worldwide.
So you got more work to do, my friend.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So I don't know if you have this memorized, but how can people get a hold of you?
Well, definitely EAWD.org. So that's EAWD.org. That's the website. And on the website, there's phone numbers and emails. You could contact me in my office at the 516-622-1823. And, you know, give me a call. We could talk about ideas. We could talk about your career. You know, we could talk about any type of artistic endeavor that you would be looking to, you know, grow and build on.
Wow.
So really it is the website, EAWD.org. It has a lot of cool articles, it has a lot of cool videos. It talks about our School of Excellence and stuff we're doing with artists with EAD and the programs that we're teaching to help them, you know, learn more about production, songwriting, or just creating a platform where you can market yourself. Because all of that comes into play, you know. As an artist, you need to learn about your websites, your you know, all your social media interactions and how to manage all of that, along with managing your music and your ability to produce, you know, a professional song.
I believe that when people meet, it should be organic. I believe that God has a footprint on things.
Right.
So to me, this has been a blessing this past hour and the future work that we're going to do together, because I just feel it. Sometimes you can know people your whole life and not really be close to them. Or some people you can meet 10 minutes ago and feel like you know your whole life. So, Jake Rinaldo, thank you, man. My God bless.
Thank you so much for having me.
And EAD, guys, thank you for tuning in. Chapters Network Live here at NSTV Studios. We want to thank everybody for tuning in. You have many choices. Come on back next week for another exciting guest. Chapters Network. We have about 15 TV podcast shows that are broadcasted on local cable outlets and some cable outlets around the country. So we do radio shows as well. So we're currently on WGBB on Long Island and also Tan Talk in Florida. It's simulcasted every Wednesday night. In Florida, it goes to Tampa Bay, Clearwater, and St. Petersburg. And in Long Island, also parts of Queens and Connecticut and Brooklyn.